Chapters and articles put together, but Heinz told me to tell all of you that it's not the quantity that matters but quality. But I thought that I must still mention the number. And not only that, he has been a visiting professor in China, in Indonesia, in the US, different parts of Europe, and he has also been on the editorial board of several important international history of economic journals like European History of Economic Thought and another journal, Metro Economica. He has served as a president of several associations. So it's a great privilege to have Professor Heinz here, and I welcome him.
Thank you very much indeed, Alex. It's a pleasure. Pleasure is on my part to be able to be here and talk to your students and some of your colleagues. And I'm really glad to meet you again. Yeah. I've pleasant memories of a couple of our encounters in Europe and elsewhere. So great to be here. And what I'm going to talk about today is classical versus neoclassical economics. Now, there's a potential coordination problem because you do not know me and I do not know you yet. So I do not know what kind of level of my talk I should go towards, and you might have difficulties in understanding me. So in order to keep that coordination problem at a minimum, I would ask you to intervene as soon as there is something very unclear. The emphasis is on very. I mean, no, of course, please take give questions to me. There are no stupid questions, to be clear, there might be stupid answers. So, I mean, whenever I'm not clear enough, please intervene. Now, it's about classical versus neoclassical economics. Is the only difference the neo? Are they the same, basically? Now, here at your university, at Helsinki Venture University, you have a couple of scholars like Alex and others who are very well acquainted with classical economics, have published important works in this area. So I presume that some of you are quite familiar with what classical economics is all about. Some of them, the major authors, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, I mean, and a few others. However, I might be wrong, and since some of you, I think, are not economists, it may be very new to you. At any rate, I will talk about classical versus neoclassical economics. Neoclassical, you might also know, at least those doing economics, because that is the ordinary fare you're given these days in economics curricula. You're all brought up by this kind of school, and so I think some of you at least are quite familiar with it. Now, this is an outline of the talk. I might not have enough time to go through all the things I want to talk to you about, but that is what is the program. And if you have to stop earlier because there are questions, you're keen to know answers to things that are not spelled out clearly enough, yes, you might stop earlier. At any rate, the first question one has to ask is, of course, if nowadays you do history of economic analysis, history of economic thought, if you care about the old masters, dead since a long time, Adam Smith, David Ricardo, Karl Marx, and others, does it make sense? Now, if economics would be a subject like an efficiently working market that throws away, jettisons whatever is wrong and particular, and keeps whatever is right and correct in general, then of course doing the history of economic thought is maybe a pleasurable thing, but useless from the point of view of the progress of knowledge, right? And I think the majority of economists nowadays are of the opinion that economics is such a market for economic ideas that functions perfectly, right? Keeps whatever is to be kept and jettisons whatever is no good. Now my claim here is, it is not like that. I'm not disputing that there is progress in economics in certain areas over certain periods of time, but I strongly dispute that economics is a subject that knows only progress and never regress. So that is the basic starting point. Therefore, engaging in history of economic analysis maybe is not such a bad idea, because you might because you might come across visions, ideas, concepts which have not been picked up and developed in the course of time, but have fallen to the earth down and were never developed properly. And I think there's reason to believe that this is the case. Now, of course, even in the history of our subject, we get contradictory answers. I gave you a number of people. The first guy is Jevons, William Stanley Jevons. You may have come across him, those who are doing economics. He was one of the founders of the marginal school of economics. Marginalism is another word for neoclassicism, right? Marginalism. And of course, he was of the opinion that Ricardo was all wrong, one had to start afresh, one had to do a new kind of analysis, get over the old ideas. So he was of the opinion, yes, clearly, from my point of view, there is progress because we got rid of the classicals. Karl Marx would have said, Jevons is all wrong. So go to another kind of theory. Then we have Alfred Marshall. Alfred Marshall is the big guy who tried to compromise. He said, well, the classicals had a very good theory of production and even distribution to a point, but the later economists, they provided a theory of demand, of subjectivism, utility and all that. So put the two together and you get the right theory. So there is progress in some sense. But it is not true what Jevons says, the classicals were not totally wrong, they were only partial, they were not general enough. But then, of course, there's John Maynard Keynes who came up and said, well, I mean, the classical doctrine, and he meant the neoclassical really, according to which economic systems continuously gravitate around full employment and full capacity utilization, cannot be sustained. It's wrong. You need a new theory. A general theory of employment, interest, and money, and general meaning that it encompasses, if you wish, both a theory of the functioning of the market system, creating full employment, and the non-functioning. So, Piero Zaffa, the Italian economist who lived in Cambridge, was brought to Cambridge by Keynes, said, well, neoclassical theory has some basic defects. So it cannot be trusted. So it's wrong. And then came Lucas, Robert Lucas. Robert Lucas, you're familiar with his name, I suppose, many of you. He said, well, I mean, we are doing what the classicals did, but much better, and the Keynes was all wrong. Keynes was just an ideologue. He was not a proper economist. He was not a scientist, etc., etc. So if you look at the history of our subject, you will see that people were all the time, more or less, quarreling with each other. There was not that steady progress towards truth and the good stuff. There was always a debate about ideas that were wrong and others that were considered right. So that's the thing. Now, clearly, as I already said, even only if the answer to the above question is the market functioning efficiently, if the answer is an unconditional yes, then we don't care about the classicals. At least not if you're interested in good intellectual enterprises. Reading the old masters is a waste of time and an expression of morbid antiquarianism. Yeah. You might do it if you're old and you have already a senior career and then you want to look back at what the guys in the 17th, 18th, 19th century had to say about things, and you could look down at them from the Olympic heights of modern knowledge, and they were, of course, fools. They looked like dwarfs, and you're a big hero. And that is occasionally the attitude of some of our colleagues, and I think it's just the wrong attitude. Some of them, Hume, Smith, etc., were giants. Many of the things were not understood immediately, and there are many things to be explored and developed. So I should be concerned a bit with the history of economic thought, because in my view, the Marxist economic ideas is not efficient. Not everything that is being preserved is worth being preserved, and not everything that has been thrown away was thrown away for good reasons. Occasionally, it was thrown away because of a lack of understanding. Right? And I think a simple reason for that, I mean, is that economics is concerned with such a complex meta subject that you're bound to come up with ideas which are not absolutely correct. And it is not always easily discernible that they're incorrect. Maybe it takes time to see it, but then you see it all of a sudden at a single glance. The complexity of the subject is really to be emphasized here. There is one famous physician, Planck, Max Planck, who was supposed to study economics, and he said, no, I don't do it, this is too complex for me. Too complicated. Physics is much easier, because those atoms, they never learn. You see, they're stupid. You only have to understand their law of movement. I mean, I'm kidding a bit, but that was basically his argument. Economics is too difficult because your agents, they are learning, they are changing their behaviors, they are, and so on and so forth. Now, a few reasons for the abandonment of the classical approach and the rise of the marginalist, a neoclassical one. One was clearly, since the subject is so difficult, you cannot expect from any author, whatever his or her name, that he or she comes up with a fully right answer on those difficult questions. The classical economists clearly did not, in the end, master completely the subject. The theory of value and distribution was left behind by them with open ends. And because of these open ends, of course, others could say, yo, you didn't do your homework, and therefore, I mean, we have to try a different stuff. Now, one of the main reasons why it was rejected was the labor theory of value. Are you familiar with the labor theory of value? Well, very briefly, the argument is that commodities embody certain quantities of labor needed directly and indirectly in their production. I mean, in this glass, for example, you need the manufacturing of the glass, the work that has been performed there. Then, prior to that, all the more raw materials then had to be produced, etc., etc. So if you take into account all those different kinds of labor, sum them up, let's assume it's homogeneous labor. Let's forget heterogeneous labor. This creates some difficulty. I won't get into it now. Sum it up, and then you would say, this glass exchanges for this watch, because in this watch there are so many more hours needed to produce it compared to the glass there, for this is expensive and that is cheap. Now that was a kind of approach you find indeed in Ricardo, but he was very clear that this was, so to speak, a makeshift solution. He did not believe in it completely. He said, the problem is so complex. If you think about an economy in which commodities are produced by means of commodities, the glass needs, I mean, certain materials, raw materials, needs labor of certain kinds, etc., needs certain machinery. All this, I mean, adding up, and the interdependence is too difficult. I assume just labor theory value, and that's good enough. Now, the interesting thing is, that was a major reason why it was rejected, the classical theory. But if you look at the early marginalist theorists, even Jevons, Boehm Bawerk, John Bates Clark, I'll give you some pictures of them, they also had the labor theory value. You can see they argued that basically commodities exchange according to the quantities of labor needed directly and indirectly in their production. So, I mean, the main criticism was you start from cost of production labor, whereas we start from utility. I mean, commodities only have value because people want them, because they attribute utility to them. I mean, these commodities are satisfying your needs and wants. You come from the needy side, so to speak, and not from the production side. But you end up in an equilibrium, if you wish, with the same argument. Relative prices are essentially reflecting relative labor quantities needed in production. Another argument is, of course, in Chevens, that the classics includes the one I've just mentioned, mazy and preposterous assumptions. They started from the wrong side. Assumptions matter. That was Chevens' argument, and I think he's right in this regard. Assumptions do matter. In some of modern theory, we will come to it, assumptions don't matter anymore. You can make whatever assumptions you feel useful. What matters is the kind of model and its predictive power. You see, this is Milton Friedman's instrumentalism. It's not assumptions that matter, but results and their predictive value. Now, as regards to the predictive value of economics, you might think that occasionally maybe it's not all that good. I mean, hardly any economists, apart from the heterodox ones, Keynesians, some Marxists, etc., were able to anticipate the recent problem in the economic crisis. So the predictive power argument, I think, is a wishy-washy one. I would not give it too much credit. At any rate, that's an argument. Chevens thought assumptions matter, but the classics had the wrong one because they started from production. One argument is they had an underdetermined system. They tried to determine a number of variables, a number of magnitudes, say, relative prices, the rate of profits, the crucial variable in the system, right? Wages, rents, etc. But they did not have enough equations to determine those variables. So it's an underdetermined system. Now, if you look at it carefully, I think that's a false argument, because it looks upon the classical economists from the perspective of the neoclassicals. And in neoclassical theory, for example, the wage rate in the value theory is determined endogenously, whereas in the classicals in value theory, it's a given magnitude. So they did not understand that the classicals started from a different set of assumptions, of givens, of known magnitudes in order to determine unknown ones. They thought it's the same kind of theory, which it is not. Now, to be clear, any theory needs some magnitudes which are taken to be known in order to determine unknowns. You can't have a theory where everything is unknown. If everything is unknown, everything will remain unknown to the end of life, I think. So you start from certain unknowns and you determine knowns, but the two kinds of approaches, classical and neoclassical, they're very different. Now, there are, of course, ideological reasons. Classicism was argued to be a theory which put forward the system of discord. You see, different classes of society fighting each other, quarreling about the level of wages, etc. And so that was another argument. There are further arguments which I will not explain to you, apart from one, and that is the classicals had a patchwork of different principles upon which they determined the various magnitudes, whereas what was needed was, so to speak, a single principle from which you explain everything. A single principle, and that principle, according to the marginalists, the neoclassicals, was the principle of scarcity. If and only if something is scarce, it has a positive price. If and only if it has a positive price, the quantity of that price will be distributed in the different income categories. So scarcity is, so to speak, the most important principle there. And of course, this means in distribution theory that the marginal productivity principle applies. Factors are getting paid according to their marginal contribution to what is there, needed and wanted, and which is being scarce, right? Now, if you look at economies in which you have unemployment, and there's hardly any economy which does not experience quite a bit of unemployment as time goes by, you might ask yourself, what is the scarcity and where is it to be found, right? So there's a problem. In the classical economists, you don't have such a thing. There's not the idea that the system generates from within all the time full employment. So the scarcity principle is applied only in a limited way to the rent of land, lands that are being needed in order to produce, say, rice or corn or whatever, but not to the system as a whole. Now, the argument is that the abandonment of the classical approach was premature. There were arguments against it, for sure, and some of the arguments had a certain weight. They were not incorrect, but as a whole, it was not a sufficient reason to abandon the approach. It was premature because there was no understanding of the possibility of providing a solution to the problems at hand, which however could have been provided. Now, the person who provided it was Piero Zarfa, and the book is Production of Commodities by Means of Commodities. He was able to solve certain conundrums, certain riddles, certain problems of the classical approach, and he did so in a logically coherent way, but also a way which preserved, so to speak, the substantial richness of the classical approach. So that is the classical thing. Now, the classical economists, as I would argue, are from William Paty onwards, François Quesnay, the French physiocrat, Adam Smith in particular, and David Ricardo, I mean, I think he is the most classical of all classical economists, a man of enormous intellect, not a trained economist. You're in a much better position. You're having excellent teachers here. You're getting trained in economics, and sooner or later we'll come up with economic ideas which far go beyond what this man by the name of David Ricardo was able to do. I mean, he was a stock jobber. He was at the London Exchange, very successful, by the way, and considered very highly by all his clients. And he had indeed ideas which, up until today, I think you can show, have not been fully explored. Nearly Salvadori and I tried to show that, for example, with regard to exhaustive resources and other problems, but there's no time. In modern times, there's Piero Zarfa, there's of course also Pierangelo Garigliani, a student of Zarfa's. Now, what are the features of the classical economics? Very briefly. Now, first of all, I think the classical economists felt that the economy and the society are entities which obey certain principles or laws, or at least patterns, which can be understood. It's not something which cannot be studied. It can be understood, and it can be understood in such a way that your understanding may lead to economic policies that improve the lot of mankind. It had really this perspective, and it grew out from similar ideas by Francis Bacon, the British natural scientist, who really thought that physics and chemistry and all these things were very useful things in order, in the end, to improve mankind's lot, mankind's living conditions. And this is very clear in Adam Smith, for example. He's a man who cares a lot about what he calls the laboring poor, because their destiny ought to be improved. I mean, the rich ones don't need that. The laboring poor is the kind of economic situation, is the kind of economy, are the rules, etc. Are they in favor of improving the lot of mankind, or are they not? So it could be understood, and the laws of production, distribution, the use of wealth of a nation, can that be then, the understanding of it, can it be used in order to improve the situation? They also started from society as it was. It's a society stratified in social classes. Of course, I mean, you could see that easily. They're workers that have only their laboring power, not much beyond that. Maybe a shirt and a trouser and so on and so forth, but that was the working class. They had the landed gentry, very rich, I mean, prosperous, having manor houses and whatnot. And then there was the rising class of industrial capitalists, but also traders and moneyed men. So they started from a class society where these different classes put, they played different roles in the process of the production, the distribution, and the use of the natural wealth. That's important. So they took society what it was. And they were convinced that large parts of the economy could be left to interdependent markets. That was, of course, nothing that was shared by many people. You might remember Thomas Hobbes. Is Thomas Hobbes a character you know? Thomas Hobbes, a British philosopher who argued that if, as long as mankind is in the state of nature, where everyone has access and can take whatever he or she wishes to take, there will be a perpetual war of everyone against everyone else. Bellum omnium contra omnes in Latin. The war of everyone against anyone else. So if you have a system which is left to its own, it's bound to end up in anarchy, chaos, and war. Now Smith argued this is not true because Hume had the wrong picture of humans. He saw only, so to speak, the dark sides. He did not see that there were also positive sides. There was altruism to some extent. Not much, but there was altruism. There was an understanding that, I mean, in certain schemes, indeed, you might end up in a war. But in others, maybe, if the regulations are different, you might not. So the classic economists thought large parts could be left to an economy which is organized in terms of interdependent markets. Now, there's a further aspect which is very important. They accepted the idea that people are generally self-regarding. Some might be even, I mean, very selfish. They might be rapacious. They might be even bad people. But they are following their own interests, typically. And the point the classic economists stressed very much, the Scottish Enlightenment, I'm talking about the beginning of the end of 18th century, they understood that self-seeking actions might give you what you look for, or might not give you what you look for. You might be lucky or not, but typically it generates results independently of what you had in mind. This is very crucial. So our actions typically generate results that are above and beyond of our own understanding. I mean, just think about global warming, CO2. I mean, for a long time, nobody cared about that. Nobody knew that this has any result. They were caring for many other things, so certain results come about because they are the unintended, non-planned, and maybe even non-wished results of purposeful human activity. And this has to be kept in mind. Therefore, economics and sociology and other subjects are difficult. I mean, if whatever you had in mind, whatever you intended, whatever you wanted to do really comes about, it would be easy to ask people, what do you want, what do you have in mind? And if it comes about, you just accumulate across all people and that's the result. But that is not what is happening. You see, your intentions may be this, but what happens in the real world, I mean, all these activities going on might be different from what you intended, and in addition might give you results that nobody really had in mind and intended. So, unintended consequences. This is to understand, and otherwise you're in trouble. Now, what the classics also understood in the societies about which they formulated theory is that labor is very important. Labor produces goods, and of course the question as regards the productivity of people plays a major role. Skills and dexterity, education and all that is very, very crucial. Smith was one of the first authors who actually coined the phrase that the wealth of a nation, its richness, is a result of the quantity of science applied in it. In 1776, the quantity of science applied in the economy. Because science, of course, goes into techniques, goes into methods of production, goes into productivity of workers. So that is the crucial thing. It is not trade, as in the mercantilists. I mean, selling dear and buying cheap. It is labor. And therefore, you ought to be concerned about your labor force and its development. You need education, and you need a research and development sector. Smith had that. He talked about men of speculation. These are the scientists and philosophers who find out all kinds of things, and they improve the productivity of the system. And of course, he also insisted on the fact that the extent of the market plays a role. The larger the market, the deeper the division of labor, the deeper the division of labor, the higher productivity. So these kind of things are very clear in his conception. And of course, that means that what he had in mind is a dynamic economic system. It's not a static equilibrium system, where things remain what they are. No, it's a dynamic economy which is continuously undergoing change from within, endogenous. It's not because a planet drops or a meteor drops on the Earth and things change. No, it's because the system is restless from within. So, this brings me to competition. Competition is considered as rivalry. And in competitive systems, each and every agent in the market is always in danger of being driven out of the market if he or she does not innovate or imitate in good time. Because if someone else innovates as a method of production which reduces costs of production, you can conquer the market, because you can undercut your competitors, right? So if you can undercut your competitors, then you're in a good shape. Others will imitate you in order to survive. Therefore, competition in Smith is, so to speak, a force, a social force, that it's like a whip that propels the system to ever higher levels of productivity. So competition plays an important role, and some economists these days argue that one of the problems of the former Soviet Union was that it didn't produce, in the long run, enough changes in productivity and technology, and therefore it was bound to fail. Right? So, yeah. And then there is competition, and competition also has a tendency to bring about a tendency towards a uniform rate of profits. That is the same rate of return on capital invested. It's only a tendency. I mean, it's not the argument that this is the case all the time. No, not at all. But it's a tendency, because if profitability is higher in another branch, in another sector of the economy, and if there is free competition, important term, I will explain in a minute, then capital can move, and it can move towards those employments where the rate of profit is higher, and therefore it will get a higher rate of profit, but their profitability will shrink because supply will go up, whereas in the sector where you move out, I mean, supply will go down, prices will go up, and profitability will also rise. So you have a tendency towards a uniform rate of return on capital. Now, free competition, that is, of course, a catchword. The classical Smith knew very well that in Britain of his time, there was no free competition. There was still the guild system, which did not allow certain workers to leave their profession and go to other professions, etc., etc. There were privileges. There were monopolies granted by the state. Only one firm is allowed to produce this good, others were not. But if you have free competition, this means essentially free exit from markets and free entry into markets. That is the crucial thing. Or at least, I mean, you can enter into a market, and you can compete with those that make high profits there. And you can exit from other markets which are low, right? So this is the important thing. And of course, this leads us to the surplus approach very quickly. It tries to explain all property incomes. And by property income, I mean properties of capital goods, of land, of money, etc., in terms of the product which is generated above and beyond
what is absolutely needed in order to be produced, the necessary cost of production. Now, what are the necessary costs of production? As I said, if you produce 10 glass of water, you need certain minerals, blah, blah, blah. You need to pay the workers employed in producing the glass, and you need to pay the workers employed in producing the minerals, and you need to, and so on and so forth. So cost of production, necessary costs, involve all means of production used up in the course of production, and all real wages paid to workers, that is, commodities in the end, that go to workers' households being consumed as food, as shelter, as garment, etc., etc. And once you have that, and you have, in the classical approach, you have, so to speak, the system of production as a whole of a certain economy, India, say, in 2007. The various kinds of commodities that are being produced, the costs of production that are associated with it, and then you subtract from the gross output levels all that is being used up necessarily in order to produce these things, you get the surplus product. This is the concept of net product. We know now that it's exclusive, of course, of wages. In the classic economists, wages were a part of necessary costs of production, because without workers, you cannot produce, and you must pay them the ordinary food and shelter and whatnot, otherwise they cannot do their jobs. So the rest, then, is the surplus, and the surplus is distributed in terms of profits, rents, and wages, and interest. Now, I did not talk about interest, I did not talk about rents. I will only talk about profits to focus attention on what is perhaps the most important part of it. And the argument there is, of course, as you can see, the real wage in this conceptualization for a given situation is a given magnitude. Workers are getting this and that and so on and so forth. And the rate of profits is an unknown. You have to determine it. You don't know it. The real wage, you know, that's the assumption. They start from that premise. The real wage is then determined in another part of the theory, in which they talk about capital accumulation, technical progress, scarce natural resources, and also population growth. But there is this separation dealing with the rate of profits as reflecting the surplus generated in the system, and real wages as given. Now, I can, of course, tell you that this is what you might call an objectivist perspective. Objectivist because they look really at the materials, the goods, the commodities. And if you look back in history, you find wonderful statements to this effect by, for example, William Petty, who argued, "I want to express myself only in number, weight, or measure, and leave all arguments concerning the tastes and mutable minds of people to others." You could say the second part becomes marginal utility theory. They care about people's mutable minds, you know, their desires, etc. This is left aside. Petty wants to look at the system, what it produces, what it uses up, what it destroys, because production is typically also an act of destruction. When you produce a cake, you destroy eggs and flour and sugar and salt. After you've produced the cake, they are gone. So it's a process of production and destruction, and of course you're interested in the surplus, the addition to what you're destroying. And James Mill famously put it that way, the agents of production are the commodities themselves. You see, in modern theory, an agent is something very different. It must be a human being seeking out this and that and whatnot. Here it is, a commodity. And of course, the commodities under consideration include the food for the workers. Right? The worker is, so to speak, like a machine that has to be fed, and then it produces. Of course, if it's an advanced system, then maybe workers participate in the surplus product, But the classic is starting with that simple picture. Workers are needed in production, and you feed them, and when you feed them, they can reproduce themselves, they can reproduce their capacity to work, and that's it. Now, very quickly, I mean, it's very easy, but very quickly to understand what is being meant. You see, here we have a system of production. You produce a certain amount of tools right inside, capital T, right? A certain amount of tools. In order to produce those tools, you need tools themselves. Tools enter into the production of tools, right? You need also materials, endless materials, raw materials. And you need food to feed your workers. So on the left-hand side, you have all physical inputs needed in the production of tools. On the right-hand side, right to the arrow, you have the output. Then you produce materials. In order to produce materials, you need tools, you need materials, you need food. Then you produce food, you need tools, materials, food. Of course, the lower index always gives you where a particular input is used, and of course the quantity also, they may be very different. Now, if you have a system without a surplus, a primitive, inverted commas, it's an analytical concept, society, then of course, total T equals, this should be a sum, I don't know why it doesn't work, should be the sum of all the tools you used up. And M should be the sum of all the materials you used up. And F should be the sum of all the food you used up. So you would have a situation in which you produce just as much as you use up or destroy in producing. Right? Is it clear? A primitive society. Now, of course, if for whichever reason, say weather or something else, this system is getting disturbed, the society might die out. At any rate, it will have to go to lower levels of production. And in the history of mankind, we had these kinds of societies. They lost out because they were not able to reproduce the ordinary state of affairs in the system, right? But this is a system without a surplus. Now, the classicals could not properly solve it, the Schaffer could, because they felt, well, they're heterogeneous goods, you see, to produce poor food, you need food, you need materials, you need what else? You need tools. How to get a single magnitude, the value of the thing, out of all these things. So they were on the lookout for what is known as the ultimate measure of value. And one idea then became famous, and that was labor. Everywhere I use workers, now their labor is important. And if I can reduce each and every commodity to the amount of labor needed, blah, 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 then I could have that ultimate measure of value and I could compare commodities in this way. But other workers had other ideas. Petty thought, for example, I should measure everything in bray. Bray is the ultimate measure of value. The labor theory of value was invented, as I said already, but the point is, of course, you can solve the system in terms of simultaneous equations. Right? Simultaneous equations. A question? Yeah. Yeah, please.
Yeah, so if you say that the ultimate measure of value is labor, so you need to compare between, if you take commodity A and B, and if your indirect labor to direct labor is different for both, can you still use that as a measure? I mean, can you still use that as a ultimate measure of value then?
Well, I mean, that was the idea. That was the idea of these economists. The idea was, you see, I could always say that whatever is being produced needs labor. It needs it directly on the last stage of production. It needs it indirectly. If you need tools, then in a previous period of production, you needed labor to produce tools, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, if I can add all that up, that works. That was the idea, right? But what you can see here now is you can solve the system by just putting up simultaneous equations. These things are produced simultaneously in the economy side by side. One sector produces tools, one sector produces food, one sector produces materials, and you have a solution. You can solve it, of course, only two equations are independent. One is dependent on the other one, so you have only two independent. But you can solve it, and if you take a numerical example for this one, you immediately get the solution. Now the point is, and this is crucial, the point is, in this simple system, you could say any commodity could always express in terms of what is needed directly or indirectly of any of the other commodities. You could, for example, say that one unit of tools is equal to 3 units of materials. Or you could say one unit of materials equals 2/3 units of food. You could always say that. So in other words, you could say, if you have such a system, you have not only one thing that is, so to speak, a common third equivalent in each commodity, but you have as many things as you have commodities that are needed directly or indirectly in the production of all commodities. You understand? So the labor theory value is, you do not even know from this perspective what labor values would be. You wouldn't know, right? You do not know. And if, for example, in different sectors of the economy, workers are paid different real wages, which are reflected in different amounts of food per unit of work performed, you would have to make extra calculations. So the argument is, had the classical economists not only had these wonderful, wonderfully rich conceptualizations, right? I mean, very rich ideas, but had they had the right tools to deal with them, they would not have ended up with the labor theory of value. They did not have simultaneous equations and how to solve them. That was not available at the time. Right? That was not available at the time. At any rate, this is, now, I see I'm running out of time. Do I have a few more minutes or am I boring you? Who is bored?
Confess.
No. Do you give me a few more minutes?
Yeah, sure.
Sorry. I mean, I don't want to impose myself on you. I mean, you have had a hard day, I suppose, playing football or whatever, or lying in the sun. Okay, I take a few more minutes. So that is, without a surplus. Now, what we see here is, that's the classical idea. You see, prices reflect the difficulty of production for these commodities that are being reproduced. These are all reproducible commodities. I would have to talk about non-reproducible ones, I don't have the time. They reflect the physical difficulty of production. This is indeed the classical concept of value for reproducible goods. If it is difficult to produce something, it means I have to destroy a lot of other things in order to get what I want. Right? So, the obstacles that have to be overcome, that's the Ricardian concept, right? And this, what we saw there, the prices are determined in terms of the amounts of the various commodities that have to be used up, destroyed in order to get the thing. So the above prices depend exclusively on things that have to be destroyed, yes. And each price, as I already said, might be reduced to any of these commodities involved. Now, with the surplus, let's now assume the system generates a surplus. I use the same notation, of course, but now it is clear that I assume that T over there is maybe larger, or at least as large as all the T's as inputs, right? The sum. And M is larger, or at least as large as all the M's as inputs, and F is at least as large as all the F's as inputs, and at least one of them is larger, right? You produce more than you use up. Is it clear? That's a system with a surplus. It's a modern economy, if you wish, not a primitive one. Just capable of reproducing itself. Now we have such a system, and if I now assume that labor comes into play, because workers are paid according to the number of hours they work, I have now here my physical inputs. Now wages are no longer, so to speak, under the F item here, but they are to be found here. W is the wage rate, L is the amount of labor, and then I have, of course, the gross output value, which is T times PT here,
And on the left-hand side, I have the capital input. The capital input. And I have 1 plus R. If it's a competitive system, where there's a tendency towards a uniform rate of profits, and I assume the rate of profits is uniform, then this is the equation I need, because in the gross output value on the right-hand side, I must cover all wages. I must cover the entire cost of production in terms of physical inputs, 1 times this, and I must pay a rate of return on capital on the capital invested. Is that clear? Do you understand the equation? Everyone does? Okay, everyone does. Let's assume that's correct. This is what economists typically do. Let's assume this and that is correct. So the same for the material, the same for the food. So you have now 3 equations, right? With all together, 3 prices, R and W, 5 unknowns. So too many unknowns for your equations, but you can help yourself. One is, you might be interested only in relative prices. If you're interested only in relative prices, you assume, for example, that one of the prices is set equal to 0, could also be a basket. The numerator is what Russell put, right? So if I measure in terms of food, I have a further equation. And then, of course, I can try to understand what are the properties of the system in terms of income distribution. I can fix the wage rate at a certain level, as we call the bidding factor, at a certain level. And then I ask myself, what is the corresponding rate of profits in that system? And what are the prices which support that rate of profits and that wage rate? Is it clear? So I fix the wage rate. If I fix the wage rate, then I have another equation, so I have 5 equations, 5 unknowns. I can solve the system. We can indeed, and what we get is, to begin with, Ricardo's famous finding that there is, for a given system of production, that is, those inputs and those outputs, for a given system of production, there's an inverse relationship between the rate of return on capital and the real wage rate. Right? If the real wage rate happens to go up, the rate of return on capital goes down. No doubt about it. Yeah. Right? So that is for any given system of production. And that, of course, justified Smith's famous argument about the interests of masters and workers not being the same. Workers try to get as much as possible, and masters to give as little as possible. So there's the conflict which is enshrined, if you wish, mathematically, and that R depending on W relationship. Okay? Is that clear? Yeah? So we have PR differentiation with regard to W, which is negative. Now, you could also formulate this in terms of a wage frontier, and in this case, not just 1 profit rate, but 2 profit rates, let's assume. This is the real wage rate, omega. It is omega, because it's already the wage rate in terms of some numerator, some standard value, right? And now I can ask myself, well, maybe the rate of profits is not uniform across the system, because there is some monopoly power, or some power of, say, the financial sector vis-a-vis the industrial sector, which we have experienced in recent times. Then I could say, well, okay, there's the rate of profits in one sector, here we have only 2 sectors, and the rate of profits in the second sector. Right? If I draw a 45-degree line and then cut through this thing, I would get my WR relationship I had earlier on. Just 1 rate of profits uniform across the entire economy. Right? But if now, for whichever reason, one sector is able to get a higher rate of return, let's assume this is the financial sector, then it is obvious for a given system of production that this implies either that the other sector gets a lower rate of return, or the real wage rate has to be lower, or both have to be lower. One might rise and the other one has to be lower, even more so. You understand? So when, in Germany, for example, a CEO of Deutsche Bank said the financial sector ought to get a rate of return of 25%, then I think it should have been understood by industry and other sectors that this meant, for a given real wage rate and a given system of production, that their rate of return was going down. It was, so to speak, the announcement of war. Right? It's not a positive sum game for each and everyone. There is a conflict, and one has to face that. And in more recent times, I think we really had to face the fact that certain sectors, for a variety of reasons, and it has a lot to do with policy and liberalization and so on and so forth, they benefited tremendously. And of course, they did not only benefit because things became better for them and stayed the same for the others, but because they benefited at the cost of others. I mean, the big problems we are having in the United States and why Trump has become so important is that large parts of the working class have been fell down. No? And middle enterprises in industry and elsewhere, they got into trouble. The financial sector was booming, and others paid, so to speak, the bill. You understand that? Now, this is, of course, something you learn from the classic economists, right from the beginning. They're not fumbling around. So, okay. Now, there's a choice of technique problem, but the capital theoretic problem, I think, I ought to mention at least, because that relates down to the classical theory. I think you all who are doing economics have been brought up with the idea, in macroeconomics in particular, that the rate of profits is nothing but the partial derivative of output of a social product with regard to capital. Professor Craig, we know that? Who knows it? That is what you find in all the textbooks. You see, R equals what? You don't. Well, so, I mean, if you have not come across it, lucky you, but now I just want to tell you that this is rubbish. No, I mean, honestly, I think it's rubbish. I mean, why is it rubbish? It's very easy to see, I think, and people know that it's rubbish. In a world with many capital goods, that is, heterogeneous capital goods, tools, raw materials, machines, spades, computers, right? If you want to have an idea of a quantity of capital in the system, how can you aggregate those different capital goods? Now, one possibility would be you weigh them. Right, you weigh them. You say a computer has 20 pounds and a plow has, and I add up, it's all the weight. Does not make much sense. You could also say, well, maybe it's the volume. You throw them into a sea, and then you look at the level of the sea, how it rises and falls. Does not make sense. We economists typically would say, if you want to aggregate across heterogeneous things, across different commodities, you must use prices. Right? You evaluate the different things in terms of their prices. Now, you remember still the price system we had at the whiteboard previously. You remember, these prices apparently depend on what? Also labor, all the kind of things you... What else? W. They depend on W, and if they depend on W, they depend on R. They depend on R, that is to say, if you aggregate those different things using their prices, and if their prices reflect also the rate of profits in the system, right? The K you are getting already presupposes a given rate of profits. So how can you derive the rate of profits from a magnitude that presupposes that the rate of profits is known? It's a circle. Is it clear? It's rubbish. It's a circle, right? You cannot do that, and economists know it, yeah? But they then say, well, I mean, maybe let's not go into deep kind of theoretic problems, let's assume for simplicity that things... But you see, this has an ideological element. This has a deep ideological element, if you argue like that. Because that means now that the rate of return on capital is, so to speak, a payment for the marginal product of capital, which does not exist as such, in a system with heterogeneous goods. You see, that is, I think, one of the important lessons we learned from the capital controversy in the 1960s and 70s. So,
Paul Romer is very aware of him. You know Paul Romer, the economist. He's a growth theorist. He now became the boss of the IMF, the major economist there. Now he wrote in an article, if one is going to do violence to the complexity of economic activity by assuming that there is an aggregate production function, and then all the results, how much more harm can it be to be sloppy about the difference between driver and non-driver goods? We need not be concerned about the latter part, but you see, if anything goes, anything goes. But anything goes is not the real world. In the real world, certain things go and others don't. I think that is important to keep in mind, right? Okay, still a minute?
Yeah.
And what about the students? I mean, you should ask the students because they are the customers. The customers in university, I always like this idea, the university are ordinary fare, right? Where students are customers. You are not customers. You are not customers. You are slaves. Yes, you're slaves at the hand of your professors to be molded and to be received. Yeah. Or you could also say, I mean, I used to say that in my first class, when people come to my class, they look like dustbins. You see, dustbins with opening and closing, and say, yes, you want to be emptied of the old rubbish that is inside. And we give you the new one. So emptying and filling together. So you're slaves because Okay. Now what I want to say is this. I mean, if you have a system of production and a choice of technique, then you cannot be sure that the ordinary message you get in marginalist theory, in neoclassical theory, can be sustained. And what is the ordinary message? It can be derived, I have no time, but I can give you the message. The ordinary message is, if the wage rate goes up relative to the rate of return on capital, right, then labor becomes more expensive relative to capital. And then cost minimizing firms we change their production techniques away from labor-intensive ones to capital-intensive ones. They will save with regard to the fact that it has become more expensive relative to the other one, which has become relatively less expensive, right? And this is a message which is so plain and simple that even politicians understand. No, really, that's the point, you see. This is what they understand. And then they act accordingly, right? They act accordingly. But the problem is, this message cannot be sustained in general. You may have cases where it is great. Why can it not be sustained? Because you see, if you change the wage rate and correspondingly the rate of profits, okay, then our system of production we have had previously, remember, changes relative prices. And you might get a result that because of the change in relative prices, I mean, you would eventually end up with adopting a technique, although the wage rate has increased, which is more labor intensive instead of less labor intensive. Because of all, you see, the repercussions in the system as a whole. It's very difficult to give you that message without doing some formal analysis. If you want to look at it, there's a book by Neil Salvadorian and myself, Theory of Production, Cambridge University Press. You can read it up. No? But that's the point. It's not that simple. If you have a system in which there are many commodities, they depend on each other, then because of all those difficult interdependencies, things may emerge which are not obvious at first glance, like the message I just gave you, which is the ordinary one. And if they are not obvious at first glance, then it's very difficult, of course, to tell them to people and to politicians. They believe in the simple stuff. They do not believe in what is correct.
Now, I mean, simplicity is occasionally much more important than truth. In the case of Trump, for sure. And simplicity is not enough, it must be false on top of that. False simplicity, right? False simplicity weighs more than right truth. Okay. Now, at any rate, if you have capital reversing, you might get investment functions like that. But I think I've now done enough. I have more slides, but I don't want to close myself too much. There should be time for discussion, right? So thank you very much, indeed, for your endurance. Thanks. Questions, comments, attacks? Yes.
In the previous slide, you showed the labor, I mean, in the presentation, you showed that if the price of labor rises, then you can move into a capital market, but then the unemployment will also increase if you move into the capital market.
Well, I mean, I think the point here is this, that this argument of Sarfaz and others in the capital controversy, they undermine the ordinary argument in terms of supply and demand. With these figures, you know, I mean the cross, the economist's cross, a supply function and a demand function, they undermine this. What they argue basically is that effective demand plays a role, right? Effective demand plays a role. Things are not that simple. By the way, there's a book you might wish to read by Ian Steeman and Arrigo Otto there. Is there chalk somewhere?